In the previous video, we studied regarding the law of mass action. Now, let us study about equilibrium constant. Let us consider a reversible reaction, that is A plus B giving C plus D. Now, this is a reversible reaction, hence we have put a forward and a backward arrow. We know that in a reverse reaction, the two reactions, that is forward and the backward reaction, occur simultaneously. Hence, the rate equation for the forward and the backward or the reverse reaction can be written as rate for the forward reaction. Hence, we are writing forward here directly proportional to the concentration of the reactant. So the forward reaction is A plus B giving C plus D. Here A plus B are the reactants and C plus D are the product. So the rate will be directly proportional to the concentrations of A and B. If we want to remove the proportionality sign, then we have to put a constant. Hence, the equation will now become rate of forward reaction is equal to KF. F here stands for forward reaction, concentration of A, product concentration of B. Now, if we consider the reverse or the backward reaction, then C plus D gives us A plus B. So here C plus D are the reactants and A plus B are the product. So according to the rate law, the rate will be directly proportional to the reactants C plus D. Hence we write it as rate reverse directly proportional to the concentration of C, product concentration of D. Now if we want to get rid of the proportionality sign, then we have to put a constant here. So it will become rate reverse is equal to KR. R stands for reverse reaction, concentration of C, concentration of D. We know that when a reaction attains equilibrium, then the rate of the forward reaction and the rate of the reverse reaction become equal. Hence, we can write rate of forward reaction is equal to rate of the reverse reaction. Now, we just have to substitute the above equations here. That is KF, concentration of A, product concentration of B, is equal to KR, concentration of C, product concentration of D. Now we just have to divide this two, so we will get KF divided by KR. So the rate of forward reaction divided by the rate of reverse reaction is equal to KC. Now KC here is called as the equilibrium constant, which is equal to concentration of C, product concentration of D, divided by concentration of A, product concentration of B. So this was the general explanation on how you derive the equilibrium constant. Let us now study one more example wherein you have to derive the equilibrium constant, where a balanced chemical equation is given. A plus B giving us C plus D. It is a reversible reaction since there are arrows which indicate forward and a reverse reaction. Here the small letters A, B, C and D are the stoichiometric coefficient, that is the numbers that we use for balancing, and capital letters A and B, C and D are the reactants and the products respectively for the forward and backward reaction. The equilibrium constant KC for the above reaction will be written as concentration of C raised to small letter C, product of concentration of D raised to small letter D, divided by concentration of A raised to small letter A, product of concentration of B raised to small letter B. Now if we take the reaction as C plus D giving us A plus B, so here the equilibrium constant will be denoted as KC dash. Okay, so we will get it as equal to A raised to A, product of B raised to B, divided by concentration of C raised to C, product of concentration of D raised to D. However, if you compare the two equations for the equilibrium constant, then this will take the form of 1 divided by KC. So what can you conclude from this? The equilibrium constant of the reverse chemical reaction is KC dash, and that is the reciprocal of the equilibrium constant KC. Let us understand the concept of equilibrium constant KC and KC dash by using the following reaction. So the reaction is N2, that is nitrogen, reacts with 3 times hydrogen to produce 2 times ammonia, that is NH3, and this is going to be a reversible reaction since we have the forward and the backward arrow here. Now, according to the equilibrium constant Kc, we will get it as NH3, that is the concentration of NH3, since 2 is the stoichiometric coefficient, so it will be raised to 2, divided by N2, that is concentration of N2, product concentration of H2. Now, since there is no stoichiometric coefficient before N2, it will be raised to 1, and H2 has a stoichiometric coefficient of 3, so the concentration of H2 will be raised to 3. Now, if we consider the same reaction in the reversed form, that is 2NH3, that is 2 times ammonia giving nitrogen plus 3 times hydrogen, then the equilibrium constant Kc dash will now be written as concentration of N2 product concentration of H2 raised to 3 divided by concentration of NH3 raised to 2. So basically this proves that K dash C or Kc dash is equal to 1 upon Kc. Just a simple way or a trick for you all to remember is when you write Kc, the entities or the species which are on the product side will be written up and those on the reactant side will be written down. But for Kc dash, the same reaction is written in the reverse form. Again, the entities which are present on the product side will be written up and the species or the entities which are present on the reactant side will be written down. But this becomes inverse of Kc. So hence, Kc dash is the reciprocal of the equilibrium constant Kc. Let us now move on to the next topic, that is equilibrium constant with respect to partial pressure, and it is represented by Kp. P stands for pressure. When do we use equilibrium constant in terms of partial pressure? It is for those reactions which involve gases. Let us now take a general reaction, that is A plus B, reversible form giving us C plus D. So the small letters A, B, C and D are the stoichiometric coefficient. The capital letters A, B, C and D are the reactants and products for the forward and the backward reaction respectively. And all these species, chemical species are in gaseous state. So the equilibrium constant for the above reaction using partial pressure, which is denoted by Kp, can be written as Kp is equal to capital letter P to the base capital letter C, the whole raised to small letter C, product of, again start open the brackets, P to the base capital letter D, brackets close, the whole raised to small letter D, divided by, open the bracket, P to the base capital letter A, close the bracket, raised to A, product of, again open the brackets, P to the base capital letter B, close the bracket, raised to small letter B. Here PA, PB, PC and PD are the equilibrium partial pressures of A, B, C and D respectively. Now we have to consider the ideal gas equation. The ideal gas equation we will study in chapter 10. Now I will just give it to y'all. It is PV is equal to nRT, where P stands for pressure, V is the volume, N is the number of moles of gas, R is the gas constant and T is the temperature. So if we take the component A, then we will write it as PAV is equal to nRT. In the next step, we have to shift the volume below number of moles of gases, that is NA. Hence the equation will now become PA is equal to NA divided by V into RT. However, this NA divided by V, it is the molar concentration of A in mole per dm cube. So in place of NA divided by V, we have to put the molar concentration of A, that is square brackets A. Now the equation will take the form of PA is equal to molar concentration of A, R, T. In this similar way, we will calculate for the component B, C and D. And after doing the calculations, you will get it as PB is equal to molar concentration of BRT, PC is equal to molar concentration of CRT, and for PD, you will get it as molar concentration of DRT. Now we have to study the relationship between KP and KC. KP is the equilibrium constant for partial pressure and KC is the equilibrium constant. So now we are going to consider a reversible general reaction, that is A plus B giving C plus D. Now we already have the values for PA, PB, PC and PD. The equilibrium constant for KP, that is partial pressure, is written as molar concentration of PC the whole raised to small letter c product of molar concentration of PD the whole raised to D divided by molar concentration of PA whole raised to A product of molar concentration of PB the whole raised to B. With the help of ideal gas equation, we just now deduced the values for PA, PB, PC and PD. That is, PA is equal to molar concentration of A, RT, PB is equal to molar concentration of BRT, PC is equal to molar concentration of CRT and PD is equal to molar concentration of DRT. So we just have to substitute all these values in the equation here. Hence we will get it as KP is equal to, in place of molar concentration of PC, we will be writing molar concentration of C raised to CRT the whole raised to C. Similarly for PD we will be writing molar concentration of D the whole raised to small letter d, RT the whole raised to D divided by molar concentration of A raised to small letter A, RT raised to A product of molar concentration of B the whole raised to small letter B, RT the whole raised to B. In the next step we have to take RT common. So KP is equal to molar concentration of C the whole raised to C product of molar concentration of D the whole raised to D, RT, we will write it as C plus D divided by molar concentration of A the whole raised to A product of molar concentration of B whole raised to B. Here also we are going to remove RT common, A plus B. In the next step, KP is equal to, the entire term here is going to remain constant, into RT C plus D, since it is division we have to write minus A plus B. Now in the next step again the whole term here will remain same, so it is KP is equal to molar concentration of C raised to C product molar concentration of D raised to D divided by molar concentration of A raised to A product molar concentration of B raised to B into RT raised to delta N. Delta N here is the number of moles of the gaseous species. And when you say delta, that is the difference between those of the reactants and the products. If you look here, that is molar concentration of C raised to C, molar concentration of D raised to D, divided by molar concentration of A raised to A, molar concentration of B raised to B. This is nothing but equal to KC, that is our equilibrium constant. We have already deduced this equation. So in place of this, we will be substituting KC. So what we will get, KP is equal to KC RT the whole raised to delta N. Here delta N is nothing but the difference. So that is the number of moles of gaseous products minus number of moles of the gaseous reactant. R is the gas constant and it has a value of 0.08206 liter atmosphere per Kelvin per mole. Next topic is homogeneous and heterogeneous equilibria. First, let us study about the homogeneous reactions and heterogeneous reactions. The term homogeneous, homo stands for one or same. Hence, in a homogeneous equilibrium state, all the reactants will be in the same phase. Let us consider an example wherein two molecules of hydrogen iodide In gaseous phase is a reversible reaction producing hydrogen gas along with iodine gas. So as you can see, the reactants as well as products all are in gaseous phase, that is in the same phase, and hence it is a homogeneous reaction. The term heterogeneous, hetero means two or more phases or different phases. Hence a heterogeneous equilibrium, it forms a reversible reaction in which the reactants and products are going to be in different states. Here is an example. Ammonia, which is in gaseous state, reacts with chlorine, which is again in gaseous state, to produce ammonium chloride. But the ammonium chloride that is formed here is in solid state. So if you look at the states, that is gas, gas and solid, so it is differing, right? And hence it is a heterogeneous reaction. Now we are going to study the equilibrium constant for a heterogeneous equilibria. How would you define the heterogeneous equilibrium? It is an equilibrium in which the system has more than one phase. Here we are considering the example of H2O. So first we take H2O in the liquid form, which is a reversible reaction producing water vapors, that is H2O in gaseous state. Another example is ethanol. Ethanol has a formula of C2H5OH. It is an alcohol. It is also called as ethyl alcohol. So when we take this ethanol and when we place it in a conical flask, the liquid vapor equilibrium is established. So the reaction for the above condition can be written as C2H5OH, that is ethyl alcohol or ethanol. First we took it in the liquid form. It is a reversible reaction which forms vapors. So we will write C2H5OH in the brackets G, which means vapor phase. If we want to write the equilibrium constant, that is Kc, for the above equation, then we know that the species which are in the product are written up and which are in the reactant side are written in the denominator. Hence we will write it as Kc is equal to concentration of C2H5OH gaseous phase divided by concentration of C2H5OH in the liquid phase. However, the concentration of C2H5OH in liquid phase is taken as 1. Hence, we will get it as Kc is equal to molar concentration of C2H5OH gaseous phase divided by 1. So ultimately, we are going to get Kc is equal to concentration of C2H5OH in the gaseous state. Now, why did I take the concentration of ethanol in liquid phase as 1? Because at any given temperature, the density of any liquid, it is going to remain constant independent of the amount taken, and this is the reason the term in the denominator is constant. Now if I take a reaction, that is iodine in solid produces iodine in gaseous state, so it is going to be a reversible reaction. So in the similar way, the equilibrium constant Kc is going to be equal to the concentration of I2 in gaseous state, because we know the term which is there in the denominator is going to become constant. Our next topic is determining the units of an equilibrium constant. Equilibrium constant does not have a fixed unit. It depends upon the expression of Kc. So we know that it is going to be different for different reactions. That is why the unit of equilibrium constant Kc is also going to be different. Now here we are going to consider two reactions which will help us understand it. The first equilibrium reaction is H2, that is hydrogen in gaseous phase, reacts with iodine in gaseous phase. It's a reversible reaction producing two molecules of hydrogen iodide in the gaseous phase. The equilibrium constant for the above reaction will be written as concentration of hydrogen iodide, since it is in the product side, raised to 2, because there are two molecules of hydrogen iodide, divided by concentration of hydrogen, product concentration of iodine. The concentration is expressed in terms of mole per dm cube. So while deriving the units of equilibrium constant, we will have to substitute this in the above equation. Hence we get concentration mole per dm cube raised to 2 divided by mole per dm cube, product of concentration of mole per dm cube. Now in the numerator, if you check the order, then it is raised to 2. Whereas if you check the terms in the denominator, it is raised to the power 1. Now usually we don't mention that 1, but it is raised to 1. So we have two terms, so 1 plus 1 is going to give us 2. So the equation will now become Kc is equal to concentration mole per dm cube raised to 2 divided by mole per dm cube raised to 2. Since both the terms are similar, we will have to cancel it, and that is why for this reaction Kc has no units. Let us consider the other equilibrium reaction. Here, nitrogen in the gaseous phase reacts with 3 molecules of hydrogen in the gaseous phase. Again, it is a reversible reaction producing 2 molecules of ammonia, that is NH3, in the gaseous phase. So now we need to write the equilibrium constant Kc. So it will be concentration of NH3 raised to 2, because we have 2 molecules of ammonia, divided by concentration of N2 product concentration of H2 raised to 3, because we have 3 molecules of hydrogen. Let us simplify further. Hence, we just have to substitute the concentrations of these species here. So we will write mole per dm cube raised to 2 divided by mole per dm cube product mole per dm cube raised to 3. Now we have to simplify it further. So we will get mole per dm cube raised to 2 divided by, I told you here we have two terms, one is raised to 1 and the other term is raised to 3. So 3 plus 1 is going to give us 4. So divided by mole per dm cube raised to 4. So if we cancel the similar terms, we are going to get as 2 2's are 4. So it will be mole per dm cube the whole raised to minus 2. Why I have written minus 2? Because the term which is in the denominator is going up, and that is why I have written it as mole per dm cube the whole raised to minus 2. The next step is we have to multiply that 2 with the terms which are there in the bracket. So it will be mole raised to minus 2 dm minus 3 into minus 2 is going to give us 6. So the unit will be mole minus 2 dm 6. Now, why am I saying mole per dm cube when it is written mole dm raised to minus 3? If I write it as mole divided by dm raised to 3, then it is mole per dm cube. Okay, now there is minus. So why is that minus there? Because the dm which is present in the denominator is coming up in the numerator, and that is why we put that minus sign in front of 3. So I hope you are clear with the units of equilibrium constant. Now next is the characteristics of equilibrium constant. The value of the equilibrium constant, it is independent of the initial concentrations of either the reactants or the products. This means that whatever value you get for equilibrium constant Kc, it has got nothing to do with the concentrations of the reactants or the products. The second characteristic is equilibrium constant is temperature dependent. Hence, the values like Kc, Kp, they are going to change with temperature. The third characteristic is equilibrium constant has a characteristic value for a particular reversible reaction which is represented by a balanced equation at a given temperature. So just now we deduce that the equilibrium constant does not have a fixed unit. It is going to change with different reactions. The fourth characteristic is higher value of Kc or Kp means more concentration of product is formed, and the equilibrium point is more towards right hand side and vice versa. So if Kc and Kp values are high, then they say that the concentration of the product which is formed is going to be more, and that is why the equilibrium or the stability of the reaction will be more towards right, that means towards the side of the product. And if the value of Kc and Kp is less, then more reactants are required and the equilibrium will point towards the left. So it is vice versa depending on the condition.